70 فرقة كلها في النار.
الحديث في هذا الحديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said that my ummah, the Muslim nation, will be divided into 73 different sects and groups, and all of them will be misguided. We have these hadith that the majority of this of the Muslim nation will get misguided, misled, fall into tribulations. All of these different things we do have. We also have sound, well authenticated hadith in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, where the Messenger of Allah said very clearly that a group from amongst the Muslim nation, my ummah, the Muslim ummah, will remain upon the truth until the day of judgment. A group, a portion of the Muslim ummah, the Muslim nation, will remain upon the truth, the Messenger of Allah said, and they will not be affected. They will not be harmed even by those who go against them. Until the day of judgment, they will remain.
سئل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن هذه الطائفة الناجية ما هي؟
And so then the Messenger of Allah was asked about this group that is going to be saved.
Who are they? ما كنت عليه أنا وأصحابي.
And Messenger of Allah was asked, who are these groups that's going to be saved? And Messenger of Allah answered that those group that are that he said, Messenger of Allah said, that which I'm upon and my companions, my Sahaba are upon. That's the group that will be saved.
فإذا وجدنا هذه الطائفة الناجية فلنتعلم منها وهي ما عليه مذاهب الأمة الأربعة وعليه الأشعرية وهذا واللي أجمعت عليه الأمة فلا بد أن نجد قوما من هؤلاء حتى يأتي أمر الله.
And so the Messenger of Allah said, that which I'm upon and that which my companions, my Sahaba are upon. That's the group that will be saved. And the Shaykh is saying that group is the four Sunni schools of Islam in sacred law, in fiqh. Which of course we all know is the schools of Sayyid Imam Malik, Sayyid Imam Abu Hanifa, Sayyid Imam Shafi, Sayyid Imam Ahmad. Those are the four Sunni schools of sacred law. As well as, in addition to that, the two schools of creed or Islamic belief.
Yeah, one school.
Now, which in reality, they are in reality, in essence, only one school, which the Shaykh has mentioned today, as they are known by the two names of the Ash'aris and the Maturidis, which in reality,
there's
no difference. First of all, there's no difference between the Ash'aris and the Maturidis. They are one and the same, the Shaykh is saying.
وجدت لكم التصحيح اقرأوا الطحاوية. أنا قلت لكم اقرأوا الطحاوية. هذه ما كان عليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه.
And if you want to know what, and again, the Shaykh also is saying, there's no different, the Ash'aris and Maturidis, they're not anything different than the four Sunni schools of sacred law. In other words, it's all one group. You have four schools in sacred law, and you have one school in sacred in belief, which is the Ash'ari / Maturidi school. It's known by both names. That's what you have. That's Sunni Islam. That's what the Messenger of Allah was upon, and his Sahaba was upon. Read, the Shaykh is saying, the Aqidah Tahawiyah. This Aqidah's creed, codified, written down by Imam Tahawi, who, like the Shaykh said, is from the Salaf, who, like the Shaykh said, the entire Ummah is in consensus that he was right guided, and all he did was write down what the Messenger of Allah was upon and his Sahaba was upon. That's all that it is. That's what this creed of Imam Tahawi is.
هذا مجموع ما كان عليه الصحابة والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
It's just a compilation. It's a compilation of what the Messenger of Allah was upon and what his Sahaba was upon. So if you want to be from that safe sect, go read that book. That's what it is. That's all it is. Question.
My concern is that especially about the immigrant society in this country from Indo-Pakistan. We have a disease.
سنتكلم عليه هذا إن شاء الله.
The Shaykh said, the question was, yani the question was that my concern is about the immigrant Muslims here in America, especially from the Indo-Pak community who have this disease. And the Shaykh is saying we're going to speak tomorrow.
تفضل ادعو من شئت. ادعو من شئت.
The Shaykh is saying tomorrow's whole subject is going to be about diseases of the heart.
ادعو من شئت.
The Shaykh is saying call whoever you want.
وسيسمعون الحق من الكتاب والسنة.
Call anyone you want who has any disease. Tomorrow the whole subject about the heart, and you're going to hear from the Quran and Sunnah about the disease of the heart and how to purify.
ادعو من شئت من ديسي ومن العرب ومن.
Call whoever you want from the Desi people, the people of the Indo-Pak community or the Arab community or any community, bring them with all of their disease tomorrow. The whole subject is going to be about disease.
سنجيب عن ذلك.
We're going to answer those issues tomorrow.
فهذا يوم مخصص لذلك.
Then tomorrow is specially for that. For
لأن المرض الذي أنتم مصابون به هو الكبر وهو الغفلة وهو الحسد.
And the Shaykh is saying that the diseases that we are, that you all are afflicted with is arrogance and heedlessness and and these diseases of the heart.
وستسمعونه إن شاء الله.
And you will hear about them in their clear and their full explanation in detail tomorrow.
But I wanted incorporate tomorrow.
So please break down your question, inshallah. We'll answer it tomorrow.
ما في أي مشكلة.
We'll give the question, inshallah. We'll be asked the answer tomorrow, inshallah.
لا بأس. No. جزاك الله خيرا.
Allah reward.
شكريا.
Thank you.
ما شاء الله. تفضل.
Question.
قبل أن نشرع في السؤال. احذروا من دروس العلم بدون شيخ واحذروا من الأئمة المضلين.
Before the sheikh gets into the next question, he's saying, be wary, be very cautious and wary from lessons of sacred knowledge without a proper sheikh or proper qualified teacher. And be very wary,
من الأئمة المضلين.
From those leaders of the Muslims who are misguided people. Be very wary and cautious.
وأول علامات الأئمة المضلين أن يقوم لكم واحد من باكستان ومن الهند ويقول لكم لا تقلدوا أبا حنيفة. هذا هو أول الضلال.
And the very first sign you could say who someone is misguided is to have somebody coming from India or Pakistan, which of course are lands, which is overwhelmingly majority of the Hanafi school of sacred law, to someone to come.
هي علامة الضلال.
Someone to come from these lands and to say, don't follow Imam Abu Hanifa. That is the very
واسمعوا لقولي.
That's the very and don't follow someone to come from these lands, which is overwhelmingly from the Hanafi school of sacred law. There's someone to come from these lands and to tell you, don't follow Imam Abu Hanifa and his school, but follow what I have to say. That's the very first sign you can take that this person is a misguided.
ذيك هي العلامة.
That's the very first sign that they're a misguided person. They're going to misguide you.
أو يقولكم my opinion.
Or that they come to you and they say, this is my opinion.
هذا هو علامة الضلال.
This is a sign of misguidance.
ما نحتاج إلى علامة أخرى. أنا أقول لكم إذا كنتم أبلد بليد واحد قام له عمامة بيضاء عجمي من الباكستان أو الهند عجمي ابتداء لا بد أن يكون عجمي هذا أصله وفرعه هذا ابتداء ووقف لكم على هذا المنبر وقال لكم قال الله ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال أبو حنيفة وأخطأ وكذا أنتم إذا كنتم أبلد بليد تقبلون كلامه إذا كنتم أبلد من الحمير.
And so the Sheikh is saying, Yani, if somebody comes to you and he comes and stands up on this minbar, on this pulpit of the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, wearing a white turban, and he comes from the Indian.
وما بقي له لا يدفن في القبر. ما بقي له لا يدفن في القبر.
And he comes and he's an old man. Old man looks like a coming a big Sheikh, and he's coming from the Indian subcontinent, India or Pakistan. And he's wearing a white turban. And he's a very old man.
ثوبه كله ثوبه ثوب شناسة.
And he's wearing a white clothes, white thobe.
شاب وكبير.
Now whether he's young or old, yet he's dressed in this way, outwardly according to the sunnah, coming from the Indian subcontinent. And he is, first of all, he's ajami. He's not Arabic speaker, understands the Arabic language. Beginning and end, he doesn't understand the Arabic language. He's completely non-Arab. Yet he has no knowledge of the Arabic language.
ولو تعلم شيء من العربية يتعلم من السعودية.
Yani he begins first of all that he's from a land which is not an Arabic speaking land, so he starts off from that starting point. Then if he did learn anything from the Arabic language, he learned it from Saudi Arabia. Okay.
وهو أضعف من شرادة.
And he is very weaker. He's weaker than a locust. Yani you know the locust.
أضعف من شرادة. لو قلنا له قال الله يقول قال ما هي أصل قال لا أصل هي قوالة أو قيالة. باع أصلها بيعة أو باوعة لهذا لما ما سمعنا بهذا في آبائنا الأولين نباه عشر ما سمعنا بهذا في آبائنا الأولين.
So the Sheikh is saying, يعني his Arabic language is weaker even than an insect, even than a locust. It's that weak. يعني if he gets up and says to you, قال again he's speaking about this Indo-Pak non-Arab person who even if they learned Arabic, if he gets up and says to you, قال الله, Allah has said. If you ask him, what is the origin of the word قال in Arabic? What is the source? Is it from قولة or قيالة? يعني what is its origin?
هل إنها يائية أو واوية؟
نعم. Is it يائية أو واوية؟ What is the origin of the ba? نعم. What is the origin of the letter ba in the Arabic language? He would say, يعني we never heard anything about this. يعني as I said in the Quran, we never heard anything about this in our ancestors. يعني
من آبائنا الأولين.
From our ancestors, we never heard anything about this.
لأن باه عشر.
يعني because his ancestors are non-Arabic speakers. The point is that his Arabic is so weak that he doesn't even answer simple questions like this. And if this person gets up in front of the minbar and he's in this state, like the Sheikh said, non-Arabic speaker, Arabic is so weak, and he's
قال لكم قال الله ورسوله.
And he gets up wearing the imama and the turban and dressed in all white, and he gets up and say, Allah said, and the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, and he tries to say, follow Allah and His Messenger, and don't follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala. He gets up and says that to you. And he's literally coming from a land which is overwhelmingly from the Sunni school that follows Imam Abu Hanifa. And he says that all that to you, follow Allah and His Messenger and don't follow the Imam Abu Hanifa. only the dumbest of the dumb, who's so foolish and dumb he's worse than a donkey, would listen to that. Only someone dumber than a donkey would listen to such a person.
كان واحد ضال في زمن أسد بن الفرات أحد تلامذة الإمام مالك رحمه الله تعالى في المغرب العربي دجال فصار يتكلم ويخطئ مالك في 40 مسألة فأسد بن الفرات استهزأ من كلامه لما سمع الناس قال يا قومي هذا الرجل كمثل رجل رأى البحر وأمواجه تتلاطم فبال وقال هذا بحر آخر.
And so the story, yani the example that we just gave of this person who's getting up and saying this, it has an example from the previous time, which is that in the time right after Imam Malik had a great one of his greatest students. His name is Asad ibn al-Furat. Asad ibn al-Furat is one of the greatest students of Imam Malik, who's a great, great scholar of this deen. Now, and he was living in the time in Morocco, in what's known as al-Maghrib in the Moroccan lands.
Al-Maghrib
al-Arabi. It's not just Morocco, but it's those West African lands. That's where he was living. And that this Asad ibn al-Furat, rahimahullah ta'ala, this great scholar of Islam, a person was speaking and saying, wal'a'udhu billah, he was saying that Imam Malik says this, and he was wrong in this legal issue. And Imam Malik said this, and he was wrong in this legal verdict. And Imam Malik said this, and he was wrong in this judgment. And so the person was saying, Imam Malik made these mistakes. In over 40 different legal issues and verdicts, Imam Malik made mistakes. A person got up and said all those things. That, wal'a'udhu billah, this person was saying Imam Malik made mistakes in over 40 different legal rulings and judgments. Asad ibn al-Furat, one of the greatest students of Imam Malik and a great scholar of this deen, heard that. And he said to his students and the people around him, he said, the parable and likeness of this man is like a person who saw the ocean and saw the waves of the ocean, these enormous waves of the ocean crashing up against the beach. And then that man urinated onto the ground and said, this urine is an ocean like that ocean. The parable and likeness of the man who's saying this about Imam Malik is like a man who saw an ocean with all of its immense waves as big as mountains crashing up against the shore, and then he urinated on the ground and he said, my urine here is an ocean just like that ocean.
هذا الباكستاني أو الهندي بال وقال هذا بحر آخر.
And so the same thing about this Indian or Pakistani person who's going to come and tell you this and try to say this about Imam Abu Hanifa is that what he's saying, he's urinating and he's trying to say, my urine is an ocean, just like that ocean you see.
اسمعوا رجل يقول الإمام الشافعي جعلت مالكا حجة بيني وبين الله جعلت مالكا حجة بيني وبين وأنا غلام من الغلمان مالك وهو يقول قال وأخطأ كأنه عاد.
Imam al-Shafi, rahimahullah ta'ala, one of the four mujtahid imams of this ummah, who has his own
school. أنا غلام طفل من أطفال
Imam al-Shafi means he's at the pinnacle, one of the highest levels of scholarship of this ummah. He's an imam who has his own school of sacred law, which is followed to this day. Imam al-Shafi, he says that I made Imam Malik a proof between me and Allah. In other words, he's discounting his own self. He's saying, I'm not relying on my own self. I take Imam Malik as my proof between me and Allah. I am just a slave from the slaves of Imam Malik.
أنا غلام طفل من أطفال مالك.
I am a child from the children of Imam Malik. Imam, who's saying this? One of the greatest scholars of the Ummah, Imam Shafi, who has a mujtahid imam at the absolute pinnacle of knowledge of this Ummah, who has his own, he has his own madhab.
والإمام الشافعي بنفسه يقول كل الناس عيار على فقه أبي حنيفة.
And then Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, that same Imam Shafi, who is at the pinnacle of knowledge of this ummah and a mujtahid imam, he says all of the people are dependent upon Imam Abu Hanifa in fiqh. All of the people are dependents, like children upon Imam Abu Hanifa in fiqh.
من يقول فيه الإمام الشافعي هذا ومن هو الإمام الشافعي؟ قال العلماء ما من أحد يكتب الآن في ورقة من أيام الشافعي إلى يوم القيامة إلا وللإمام الشافعي عليه حق.
And who is this Imam al-Shafi who said both of these things? He said what he said about Imam Malik, and he said what he said about Imam Abu Hanifa. Yani, he said these enormous things about them, enormous types of praise about
العلماء, them. علماء الحديث وعلماء الوصول.
Who is this Imam al-Shafi who said these things? The scholars of hadith and fiqh and the scholars of Islam, they say Nobody came from this ummah, from the Muslim nation, from the time of Imam
al-Shafi
to this day and until the day of judgment. Nobody from the Muslims has come or will come until the day of judgment who writes a single word except that Imam al-Shafi has a right over them for the what he spread of knowledge.
لأن كل الناس يحتاجون إلى علم الأصول وهو أول من ألف وقع
عدد. The proof of that is that Imam every scholar of the Deen, anyone who writes anything about this Deen, is dependent upon the science known as أصول الفقه or the foundation.
أصول العلم كلها.
Now, which is the legal methodology, how you derive legal rulings from the Quran and Sunnah. That's called أصول الفقه. And every scholar is dependent upon that because by that science you understand how to derive sacred law from the Quran and Sunnah. And Imam al-Shafi is the one who codified that science. He's the one who first wrote it and expanded it and explained it. And so the scholars say nobody comes from the time of Imam al-Shafi and throughout the history of Islam to this day and until the day of judgment and writes even one word about Islam except that they are dependent upon Imam al-Shafi because he's the one who codified, wrote down, explained, and expanded upon that science. Despite all of this, Imam al-Shafi is speaking about Imam Malik and Imam Abu Hanifa in this way. Despite all of this. And this person is getting up on the minbar and speaking about these Imams in this way. This is madness. It's also stupidity and foolishness and stupidity.
فلا تقرأ العلوم بدون عالم بدون معلم لا أقول عالم معلم يعرف فرائض العين ويدرسها على كتب الأقدمين كهذه المذاهب المشهورة واحذروا من طلب العلم بدون ذلك واحذروا من أونلاين وسكايب وهاي.
And so the Sheikh is saying, يعني like he said, يعني finding an alim, a proper alim with the true meaning of the word, يعني the Sheikh is saying it's extremely rare. So he's not ordering you to go seek that out. But he's saying find a mu'allim, يعني a teacher who knows at least the fundamentals, the essential knowledge, these basic knowledge, how you purify yourself, how you pray correctly, how you do fasting and salat and zakah correctly, how what you believe in Islam at its basic level correctly, according to, the Sheikh said very clearly, the traditional classical works of Islam. Not the modern works, the works of our ulama who came before from the classical works, that they can teach you according to their works. And that you gotta be very wary and cautious from online teaching and from students of knowledge who aren't qualified to teach what they've learned, and be very wary of online and Skype and these tools. If you have a solution and a means to learn other than the online.
لكن أنتم لا تريدون أن تبذلوا في العلم شيئا.
If you find a means and a way to learn.
أنتم لا تريدون أن تبذلوا في العلم شيئا.
You do not wish to give out or spend or sacrifice anything for your sake.
كلكم يدفع في إيجار البيت 3,000 و4,000 و5,000 ولا يدفع في إنقاذه من النار شيئا.
Everybody is spending $3,000-$4,000 monthly for their rent of their home, mortgage on their home, and they don't want to spend out even a dime to save themselves from the hellfire. That's our problem.
هذا خطير.
That's very dangerous.
لا تدرس العلم بدون معلم.
And don't learn.
لا تكونوا كتوم الحكيم.
Do not learn. Don't learn without a teacher, because you will wind up like the like they said about this one story about this person.
توم الحكيم.
نعم. نعم. Who was يعني this حكيم? He was a حكيم who was a spiritual healer, who was not a spiritual healer, يعني a medicine man. He was a حكيم, like a medicine man. Who a natural healer who would treat people with like natural remedies and these things. Now,
طبيب,
doctor. He was a doctor of the pre-modern times, a natural healer who a medicine man who would treat people with natural herbs and things.
إذا رمت العلوم بغير شيخ ضللت عن الصراط المستقيم.
And the lines of poetry go that say, like the Sheikh recited, that if you seek sacred knowledge without a teacher, then you will go astray.
Like وتنطمس العلوم عليك حتى تكون أضل من توم الحكيم.
And that if you try to seek knowledge without a teacher, the knowledge will become confused. You will become confused about this knowledge, and it will become
تلتبس العلوم عليك وتضل ضلال لا نهاية له.
It will become confusing for you, and you will become you will misunderstand it. Just like this one, this medicine man became misguided, يعني and misunderstood. Which we're going to give you his story.
توم الحكيم كان يقرأ من كتب الطب حكمة الطبية وكان عارفا لا يغلط دائما لا يغلط لا يوجد له غلط وفي يوم من الأيام قرأ في كتاب الحبة السوداء تشفي من الرمى.
And so the story goes about this medicine man that he was an
كان لا يخطأ.
He was someone who never made a mistake. He was very carefully studying and reading from his medicine books. We're talking about now pre-modern times, like a natural healer or medicine man. And so he would very carefully study his books about how to give prescriptions, how to cure this illness or this disease, use this herb, use this medicine to cure people. And he was very, very careful on it and studied it very carefully, his books, and he never used to make a mistake in it. Until one day, he read this one line in one of his medicine books, which said that the al-habbat al-sawda, in Arabic, al-habbat al-sawda, the black seed cures the disease of the eye. The black seed cures the disease of the eye.
Al-habbat alif lam ha ba ta marbuta.
Naam. And so in Arabic, what the book had written was al-habba, al-habbat al-sawda. In Arabic, black seed, in Arabic, seed is habba. Alif, lam, ha, the letter ha, yani alif, lam, ha, ba, and then what's called ta marbuta, the tie gap. Yani those who know Arabic. Alif, lam, ha, ba, ta marbuta. That's habba in Arabic, which means seed. So he read in his book, in the al-habbat al-sawda, naam,
والباء تنقط نقطة واحدة من أسفلها.
Naam. And so what the problem was in the book that he was reading from, that's what it was supposed to say. Al-habbat al-sawda tashfi min al-ramad. Yani the black seed cures the disease of the eye. That's what it was supposed to say. The problem was the book was missing the dot. You know the ba letter in Arabic, those of us, most of us know enough in Arabic, the ba is like this with one dot underneath. The book was missing the book had one extra dot, yani za'id nukta.
فجعل نقطة ثانية الحية السوداء تشفي من الرمى.
Now, and so it was only one dot. Instead of saying يعني
فصارت ياء.
Instead of the ba, it had one extra dot. And those who know Arabic, if you put two dots underneath, what does it become? From a ba, it becomes a ya. So the word became, instead of habba, seed, it said al-hayya, which means the snake.
فقال الحية السوداء تشفي من الرمى.
So he said, oh, okay, the black snake cures the diseases of the eye.
فأخذ على السم في عينه وعمية.
And so he took the black snake to bite his eye, to get the poison from the snake to cure his eye. As the book said, he read the book exactly like it said, the black snake cures the diseases of the eye. So he let the black snake bite him in the eye and it cured his eye, and he went blind.
وأنتم ستعمون.
يعني, and you will go blind.
أنتم ستعمون عماء لا رجاء بعده.
And you will go blind. I have no doubt about it. I am so.
ما في شفاء لا تنفع فيه الدكاترة.
There is no cure of it. There will be no doctor will be able to cure you of the blindness that you will receive if you go and read from the books like this.
إن الله تعالى يقول إنها لا تعمل أبصار ولكن تعمل القلوب التي في الصدور.
Allah Ta'ala says it's not the eyes that go blind. It's the hearts that are in the people's chest, in their breasts that go blind.
فأنتم لو أنكم الإمام الشافعي كيف تفعلون؟ لو أنكم الإمام الشافعي.
And so if you were Imam al-Shafi yourself, if you literally were Imam al-Shafi yourself, what would you do?
من كان الإمام الشافعي؟ ما هو الإمام الشافعي؟
Who is Imam al-Shafi? Who
معروف أنه حفظه لا يسمع شيئاً إلا وعلى قبيل ما ينساه من مرة واحدة.
Imam al-Shafi was such a scholar of this deen that he was well known and widespread famous for the fact that he would memorize things with a photographic memory. Literally, the first time hearing it or seeing it, he would have it completely memorized. And he was well
known. لا يحتاج إلى مرة ثانية.
He would never need to hear or see the thing the second time.
العرب الفصحى كانوا يسمعون كلامه لتصحيح لغتهم وفصاحتهم.
The Arab people, he was Arab himself, but the other Arabs would go to him to learn correct and proper Arabic.
العرب البادية. فصحاء البادية.
Who was the most knowledgeable people of Arabic? It would be the Bedouins. The Bedouin Arabs in their desert were known to be the most knowledgeable and most purest people in their Arabic language. Despite that, they would go to Imam al-Shafi to seek out the correction of their Arabic speech. That's the level of Imam al-Shafi in memorization and in his perfection of Arabic speech.
ومعروف أن معرفته بأساليب لغة العرب والقرآن وفصاحته لم يبلغها عالم في زمنه.
And that it's well known that Imam al-Shafi reached a level in memorization, knowledge of the Arabic language, knowledge of the Quran, knowledge of the Deen that nobody.
وأول من أصل أصول القرآن والحديث.
And nobody reached the level of knowledge he had like he had in his time. Nobody was at his level in his time. And he was, like we said, the first one who codified the sciences of أصول الفقه, legal
أصول العلم, العلم كلها.
يعني legal methodology, أصول الفقه, which is the source of all knowledge, because it's the knowledge which teaches you how to correctly derive law and understanding from the Quran and Sunnah. Who codified that science? Who wrote it down and made it clear? Imam Shafi'i did.
لما جاء إلى مكة سأل عن من في المدينة من العلماء ومن هو المفتي بها قيل له الإمام مالك.
So this is Imam Shafi'i. This is who we're speaking about. When he came to Medina al-Munawwara,
مكة.
Imam Shafi'i رحمه الله.
كان يقرأ لغة العربي يتعلم فصاحة العربي في الخارج.
نعم Imam Shafi'i. He first began. He went out and he studied the Arabic language outside of the cities to perfect his Arabic language. He went there first until he perfected his Arabic language to the highest level. Then he came to Mecca and he asked, "Who is the greatest scholar of the time?"
في المدينة.
In the city of the Prophet.
إن هذا واصل العلمي.
Who is the greater? يعني Imam Shafi'i. He then came to Mecca and he said, "The city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is يعني the center of the Muslim world." And so he went to Mecca and he asked in Mecca, "Who is the greatest scholar right now in Medina al-Munawwara, in the city of the Messenger of Allah?"
قيل له مالك.
And they said to him, Imam Malik.
قال ماذا ألف؟
And they said to him, Malik, this person named Malik is the greatest scholar in the city of the Messenger of Allah somewhere in this time. And so Imam Shafi'i asked them, what is the author? What books have he authored?
قال الموطأ.
And they said he's authored this book known as the Muwatta, which is the great work, the great book of hadith of Imam Malik.
أول كتاب في صحيح الحديث.
And it's the first book that was been written in the history of Islam
جمع
to collect the correct and authentic chains of hadith. Yani the first his book in the history of Islam that was specifically written to gather together the correct and authentic narrations of hadith was the Muwatta Imam Malik. Prior to that, they used to collect whatever hadith they could and gather whatever they could into the books. But the first one who said, I'm going to write a book specifically to sort out what is the most authentic hadith of the Messenger of Allah, which is a very great task, a very weighty task. The first one to ever do it was Imam Malik, and it's his Al-Muwatta.
أخذه وحفظه في سبعة أيام.
So Imam Shafi'i asked, what's that book? They said, Muwatta Imam Malik. So Imam Shafi'i took that book and he memorized it in 7 days. He completely memorized that book by heart, an entire book of يعني آلاف الأحاديث. Yeah. It's thousands of hadith in the Muwatta Imam Malik. Imam Shafi'i took the book and memorized it by heart, completely beginning to end, in 7 days.
ماذا فعل بعد ذلك؟
So now he's memorized the book. He memorized the book 100% by heart.
وهو محتاج إلى العربية، وهو محتاج إلى معرفة
الأصول. He's not in need of the Arabic language. He's
absolutely. وهو محتاج إلى علم الأصول.
He's a master of the Arabic language. He's a master of the Quran and all these different ulums, Arabic language and the science of Quran. He's the codifier of usul al-fiqh. He's a memorizer now of the Muwatta Imam Malik. He's got all of these things. So what does he do?
ذهب إلى مالك وجلس معه 9 سنين.
He goes to Imam Malik and he sits with him for 9 years. 9 years after memorizing the book, beginning to end by heart, the point the Shaykh is making is that he didn't rely upon memorizing a book from the book. He did not rely on that. He memorized it in 7 days first, then went to Imam Malik and sat with him for 9 years reading the book with Imam Malik.
وأنتم تعرفون ماذا كان الإمام الشافعي وما درس بعد ذلك؟ هل ذهب إلى اليمن وإلى العراق وكم جلس مع من العلماء؟
And then after studying with Imam Malik for 9 years, his Muwatta, then he goes on. Imam Shafi'i doesn't finish there. He goes to Iraq, he goes to Yemen, and he goes all over the Muslim world, continuing this to study and gain knowledge from all the different ulama of his time.
هذا شأن السلف.
This is the way the Salaf.
كالإمام مالك يقول جالست ابن هرمز 17 سنة وفي رواية 16 سنة وفي رواية 13 سنة من الصباح حتى الظهر.
And like Imam Malik,
شيخ واحد.
Imam Malik says about his teacher, or his primary teacher Ibn Hurmuz, that Imam Malik says, I sat with him for 17 years. 17 years. In another narration, 16 years. Imam Malik says that he sat with his primary teacher Ibn Hurmuz.
هذا معلم واحد.
This is one of his teachers. It's not his only teacher. It's his one primary teacher that he sat with him for 16 or 17 years, depending on the narration, from Fajr ila Dhuhr.
نعم.
From Fajr time until Dhuhr time. For 16 or 17 years, Imam Malik studied. That's just only one
وكل, of أكمل, أكمله من الشيخ فقد أجازته 300 وبضع.
And Imam Malik has how many sheikhs? It's been, he was given ijaza to teach, given permission to teach, meaning that he has over 300 sheikhs. He had over 300 sheikhs. Just one of them is Ibn Hurmuz, which he spent 16 or 17 years with every day from Fajr until Dhuhr.
وأنتم لا تقرأون شيئا وعشا.
And we and you and all of us, we don't read anything. First of all, we don't read anything like that. No, and on top of that, we are not even Arab speakers. يعني we haven't even had the level of Arabic language.
ولا تكلموا عن غير العربي بل من يقول إنه عربي.
يعني and the Sheikh is not speaking when he says we are non-Arabs, we are not Arabic speakers. He's not talking about actual non-Arabs. He's talking to the Arabs. The Arabs today are not Arabs. The Arabs today don't know the Arabic language.
لو قل لأحد الآن ما هو أول معنى كتابك؟ الحمد لله رب العالمين. لا أعرف ما معنى أل.
If we said to one of them, these people, the Arabs today.
شيوخ العرب. شيوخ العرب.
يعني if we يعني if we,
شيوخ العرب الآن.
We said to يعني قبيح في السن.
شيوخ لا لا.
One whoever calling themselves sheikhs, not just normal Arabs. People will call them the sheikhs.
ولو ما معنى أل الحمد لله رب العالمين.
If we went to the people.
غالبهم لا يعرفوا معنى.
Who are calling themselves sheikhs from the Arabs? And we ask them, what is the meaning of Allah Ta'ala in Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen? They would not be able to explain the Al. These are not just Arabs. The sheikhs of the Arabs today, majority of them, would not even be able to explain, not Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. They would not even be able to explain Al out of Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So the point the sheikh is making, when he says non-Arabs in this way, he's not talking about some type of division between the Arabs or non-Arabs. He's saying the Arabs today don't know the Arabic language. So then what would you say about people who literally don't know anything of Arabic?
ولذلك يقول ابن العربي القاضي ابن العربي الفاسي رحمه الله تعالى المالكي يقول من لم يفرق بين نزول الجمل ونزول الجمل فلا يستحق أن يتكلم في الجمل.
Subhanallah. And then, so for this reason, Ibn al-Arabi, from Fas, from the city of Fas.
هذا القاضي المفتي العالم المحدث الأصولي.
He is a masterful scholar, a qadi, a judge.
القرن الخامس.
A scholar from the 5th century after the Hijra, from Morocco, the city of Fas, al-Qadi Abu Bakr Ibn al-Arabi, who is a master judge, a master of the.
قاضي الأصول والحديث.
A master scholar of the usul al-fiqh, legal methodology, a master scholar of hadith, a master scholar of all these different sciences of the sacred law from the 5th century of after the Hijra from Morocco. He's Al-Qadi ibn Abu Bakr ibn Arabi. He has the saying that says, whoever is incapable of differentiating between Nuzul al-Jamal wa Nuzul
al-Jumal.
Yani, these are two different words in Arabic.
من لم يفرق بين نزل الجمل ونزل القرى.
Now,
هذه معاني وهذه أجسام.
Yeah, think about it. Somebody in Arabic, you have two different words. One is jamal, which means camel, and another word is jumal, which is sentences. They're two words. They only differ. The letters are exactly the same. Alif lam, jim, mim, lam. But the vowel is different.
Jumal.
One of them is jamal, al jamal.
Jumal معاني.
Al camel, and the other is al jumal, which means يعني sentences or meanings. يعني meanings.
Jumal يعني معاني الجمل.
Meanings, يعني meanings of sentences. يعني.
نزل القرآن هذا جمل.
نعم. So the point is, and both of those two words, al jamal and al jumal.
من لم يفرق بين نزول المعاني ونزول الأجسام.
نعم. Both of those words, jamal, camels. And jumal, meaning sentences or meanings of the sentences, they both can have a type of nuzul. In Arabic, nuzul means coming down. You can say about both of them that you can come down. Can't you say that you yani nuzul al jamal, yani the camel, either the camel itself comes down or you get off of the camel. Both of those would be called nuzul al jamal, naam, coming down from the camel, and nuzul al jumal, yani
can nuzul al Quran min al sama,
yani the coming down, which would mean yani the revelation coming down, the meanings coming down of these meanings of the Quran. Both you would, one you would call nuzul al-jamal, coming down or getting off of the camel. The other you would call nuzul al-jumal, the coming down or the revelation of the meanings of the Quran. Both of those two expressions in Arabic are called nuzul. And the only difference in them, the vowels or the letters are exactly the same. The only difference is the vowel, jamal versus jumal. So Al-Qadi Abu Bakr ibn Arabi is saying, someone who's knowledge of the Arabic language is so poor and so basic that they can't even differentiate between those two words. In other words, if I put between you, in front of you, those two phrases without the vowel in written, that you wouldn't be able to tell which one is which, based off of the context, yani only someone who understood enough of the Arabic language to be able to do that. Somebody who can't even do that, can't even understand from the context whether it's meant that coming down of the camels or coming down of the revelation. then they had no right and no authority to speak about the Jumal, meaning the meanings of the Quran.
لا يستحقون يتكلم في الجمل.
Then they have no right to speak about the meanings of the Quran.
وبعد أن تصلوا وتستريحون تكلم إن شاء الله وأقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله.
And so the Sheikh is saying that we will pray and we will take a break, and the Sheikh is going to finish here. He seeks refuge in Allah for himself and for all of you. We'll pray and have a break.
بارك الله.
And Allah, may Allah put reward in all of you.